Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Come on, sing it. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy. Worthy is the King who conquered. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place.
That you would bear my cross.
That you would bear my cross.
You laid down your life.
You laid down your life. That I would be set free.
Jesus, I sing for.
Jesus, I sing for.
Church, come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise in here. Come on, y'all, it's Wednesday night. Let's make Jesus welcome in the house. God is on time. Amen. Welcome to church, man. I'm excited. It's Wednesday night, and I tell you what, I love our Wednesday nights. I tell Donna all the time, Wednesday night's my favorite service of the week. Come on now. For obvious reasons, amen. And y'all don't supposed to say amen, but anyway. Listen, I'm excited about being here. Man, we got so much that's going on tonight. So much is going on at Central all the time, it seems like, you know. Can I tell y'all something? You know, I want you just to give God just one big praise, because last night we had about 55 men. Come on now. Yes. Yes. Man, I tell you what. It was absolutely amazing, and I tell you what, as we go through this thing, it's going to get better and better, and such an awesome night last night, seeing those 55 men show up and just encounter Jesus right there, you know, in those small group settings that we have, and it's just an awesome, awesome thing. It really is, and I'm excited about it. And if you're in here, you're a man, and you're in here, and you haven't, you know, you say, well, I didn't get in on that, you know, listen, it's not too late. It won't cost you a dime. Get there this Tuesday night, 6:30, we're going to have it again, amen? Praise God. It's going to be going on for a while. Amen. Praise God. And then don't forget, September 24th, we've got our What's at Stake. It's a night for men to come together. And listen, we're going to have an awesome night that night, to where we're going to have an awesome food. You know what we're going to have? What's at stake, y'all? What are we going to have? Steak. Amen. Prime rib. Come on, somebody. Amen. We're going to have a prime rib that night. And listen, it's $20 to come to that. Or if you want to just invite several people, you can purchase a table for $110. And we've already had several men that have done that. Purchase a table for $110. And you can invite who you want to invite. And say, hey, look, I want you to come be my guest and be a part of this What's at Stake night. I promise you that night is going to be life-changing. Amen? It is. It's going to be life-changing. I'm so excited about the momentum that we've got going on with our men right now. Amen? Praise God. Hey, can I tell y'all something? We got the envelopes back there, and, you know, we're just kind of debating over how long to leave them out, but we're not going to keep driving home. This will be the last night I'll say anything about it, and I want to say the reason, I may say something about it Sunday, but here's why. Because we took up $65,000, y'all. Come on, somebody. Amen. That's amazing, y'all. And I'm not boasting, but can I tell y'all something? We serve a God who is a mighty God. Amen. Praise God. Amen. During a time of COVID and all that stuff that's going on, we took up $65,000, and that is just amazing. I'm so excited about it. And we just got so much progress going on with our new facility next door, or connected to us here. Amen. You going to say something?
Amen,
you
just... God. I'm going to say something. You shut up now.
Hey, y'all make this woman welcome. Amen. Come on now. This is her night, all right? What'd she say? She tell me to shut up. Come on, man.
No, I got tickled because the whole time he's talking about the men's Bible study, men are doing this, I feel like the women are like, well, what about us? So So we got you. We got y'all. Amen. So God is good. Amen. So it's good to be in church tonight. It's good to see you guys tonight. And welcome. Amen. We can take a deep breath and just enjoy the presence of God. Amen.
Hey, if this is your first time in Central, welcome to Central.
Yeah,
because
absolutely.
I realize we may have some visitors, because guess what? We got Pastor Jason going to be preaching to us tonight. Yeah. Come on now. Yeah. Amen. Amen. And he actually pastored a church once before, and that they started there in Lawrenceville. And Andrea over here was his worship leader. So y'all make her welcome tonight. Amen. Come on. We are so honored to have you with us tonight. Amen. All right. Hey, y'all ready to worship the Lord tonight on a Wednesday night? You ready? All right. Hey, let's start it off this way. Find you two or three people you haven't spoken to. Give them an air high five or a thumbs up. Tell them you're glad to see them on a Wednesday night. Amen.
Because the I am tells me who I am.
take some time just to worship you tonight, to honor you tonight. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Oh, the splendor of the King. He's clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. And he wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice. It trembles at his voice. Come on, let's sing it. How great is our God.
My soul, my Savior God. take a moment and just tell him how great he is.
Yours is the glory. thank you for your beautiful name, because that's the name that we can call on. That's the name that we can call on when we're overwhelmed and we feel like we're going to be overcome. Why? Because we just have to be still, and we have to know that you are God. We have to trust you. We have to know that you're fighting our battles. It's a trying time for many people. It's a trying time for our entire country. But that's okay, because none of this comes as a surprise to God. He's not confused by it. He's not surprised by it. And right now, when we don't even realize that He is fighting for each and every one of us, He is fighting your battle over your health. He's fighting a battle over your sickness. He is fighting a battle over your family. He's fighting a battle over your finances. Whatever your need is right in this very moment, He is fighting for you. And when that victory comes, because it's going to come, when that victory comes, He says, you did it. Even though He's the one who did it, He says, you did it, my child, you did it. Why? Because you kept worshiping. Why? Because you kept your faith. Why? Because you held your arms up in the midst of the battle, just like Moses did. As long as we hold our arms up, we're still winning. Father God, I just pray right now for each and every person in this room, Lord, that they would realize who you are and realize that as long as they worship, as long as they trust in you, they will be overcomers. They will win those battles. They will have victory because of who you are.
You've even gone to end my war. You come back with the head of my enemy. You come back and you call me my victory. Oh. Comes my greatest defense. It leads me from the dry wilderness. And all I did was praise. And all I did was worship. And all I did was bow. Stay still. Hallelujah and hallelujah. You have saved me. It's so much better your way. Hallelujah and hallelujah. Great defender. So much my faith in hope again, and all I did was praise, and all I did was worship, all I did, and all I did was bow down, and all I did was stay. Hallelujah, hallelujah, praise. so much better your way. Sing hallelujah and hallelujah. You have saved me. So much better your way.
Sing hallelujah
and hallelujah. Great defender. So much better.
Stay in this vein of worship for just a moment. Let's just stay in this for a minute. Can you think of a time that you just had no way out? Can you think of a time when it seemed like the enemy had you counted out and you just didn't know? You were like, how is there going to be a tomorrow? I don't even know how I can come through this thing. That's what this song is for. This song is for somebody. Somebody who was counted out. Is there somebody here tonight? Were you counted out by somebody? Maybe the devil told you there was just no way you were going to make it through this. Maybe he told you you were unworthy. Maybe he said, they've forgotten about you. I'm here to declare in Jesus' mighty name, under the anointing of the Holy Spirit that is here right now, he is our great defender. He stands between us and our enemies. The Bible says that whenever Moses and the Israelites,
when they were standing on the banks waiting, not knowing what was going to come next, Pharaoh was right behind them and all of his armies. In any moment, they knew they were certainly going to be annihilated. But the Bible says God stood between the Israelites and their enemies. He would not let, listen, there are some things that the devil could. He would have already sifted you like wheat. But God said no. God said no. Let's just give him a shout of praise. Let's worship him. Bless your name, Jesus. Glory to your name, Father. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He is our great defender. Hallelujah. Sing it one more time.
Hallelujah.
Worship.
You have saved me. It's so much better.
The Lord a shout of praise if you would. Amen. Amen. Thank you guys so much. Thank you for setting the tone for tonight. Everybody can be seated. Yes. Look at somebody beside you if you would and just tell them you're so glad they're here. You know what? You don't know what that person beside you, you don't know what they went through to get here. How many of you know the enemy's always at work? I'll bet you in this room right now there's countless stories of how the devil tried to keep you away, tried to attack you. Maybe something didn't happen. Maybe there wasn't gas in your car. I don't know what the issue was, but I know that you don't know what the person beside you had to go through to make sure they're here. But in Jesus' name, we're all going to get something tonight. Amen? Amen. Now, I gotta tell you, my message tonight is only going to be as good as your expectation. And I know that I'm not, listen, I was here Sunday. Was that Pastor Daryl LeMay? Let me tell you. You have not been to church if you haven't heard Pastor Daryl take two eggs and put them to dance music and have those suckers getting chemistry with each other. I'm going to tell you, I have cried laughing over that every time I watch it. I'm just like, I just see him do it. I can't even do it. It was so good. Listen, we have two of the most dynamic voices that hold on. I'm not just saying this, okay, because I don't do that kind of thing. I'm saying I submit my family and myself under their leadership because what's coming, their voices are about to be elevated. Pastor Donna sits here and spreads revelation that comes out like this, just unreal. I'm like, you want me to preach on a Wednesday night? I'm like, my God, I want to hear you. But I am grateful for the opportunity. I'm so thankful. These pastors, let me tell you, it's not just their ability to preach, though. See, you can find a lot of people that can preach good. But they have this structure and this discipline and this organization. And there's behind all that, when you pull all the curtains back, there's this real holiness, authentic walk that all that comes from. Because, see, you can't fake it and be something you're not. Inside, there's a real, and that's what I'm most grateful for, is that I've got pastors and I come under a covering that is absolutely walking in step with the Holy Spirit. Listen, y'all, we're building an 850-seat sanctuary in the middle of a COVID pandemic, which the world has never seen. But I'm telling you right now, what happens in the natural always points to what's going on in the spiritual. See, the two are tied together. You can't have something in the natural that hasn't already first happened in the spiritual. Did you know that? Whatsoever things are loosed on earth are loosed in heaven. That could read this way. Whatever is loosed on earth was already released in heaven. Whatsoever things are bound on the earth were already bound in heaven. What is heaven? Heaven, I'm not talking about, see, you might have thought that meant that it's like the place where the harps are and the people are floating on clouds. No. Jesus said the kingdom of God is right here, right now. It is here. The kingdom is at hand. And it's the spiritual realm he's talking about. Man, you and I have the ability. I'm going to talk about it a little bit tonight. My message subject is called Pray Through Till Breakthrough. Pray Through Till Breakthrough. Man, you already got it, didn't you? Yeah. Listen, I'm going to tell you something. You won't accomplish the will of God in your life unless you learn what I'm about to teach you tonight. What I'm going to teach you has come through personal experience, is all I can say to that. And y'all, you know, when, I don't know if you've ever got a new car, but when you get a new car, sometimes you're unfamiliar with all the switches and the gears, and you know that you've seen the guy that sold the car, and that car, he could, man, I'm telling you, he could make that thing hum, and you know that you haven't had a lot of practice. That's the way I feel right now. Like, Pastor Darrell has put me in his Ferrari right here. Because let me tell you, you guys, you may not know it, but you are a Ferrari. This is a powerhouse of a church. There are some dead places that I would never want to be preaching in. But you guys have a fire about you. And I feel like I may be a little clunky at first, like I may have a hard time hitting third, but I'm going to burn some rubber in a little bit, okay? So y'all just hold with me a little bit, okay? Because I like to drive. But I got to figure out the car a little bit, okay? Y'all understand? All right. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, I thank and I praise you for the spirit that you put in this place. Let me just talk a minute here about Jesus, what was going on in the setting of my message. Jesus was, he had just come out. He was dripping with anointing. He had just put his foot on the neck of the devil. He had come out of the wilderness, the very place that the Holy Spirit led him into, where he fasted for 40 days, and he was tested by the enemy. How many of you know sometimes the Spirit of God will lead you right into a place that you feel like is a trap, and you don't know how you ended up here, but God always has a plan. And see, Jesus had to go through that. Sometimes you will too. Believe me, I've been there too. We have to sometimes trust that just because we got led into this thing and it looks like, wow, hell seems to be breaking loose now, it's just testing. So you got to learn that that is testing. Jesus comes out of this place of testing. He had overcome the enemy. It says Satan fled from him, and he comes out victorious because he continuously used the word. And he comes out, and all of a sudden, he's walking on the beach. He's taking a little vacation, I think. You know, like Jesus is walking along the lakeside, and he sees some guys that he's like, you know what? They may be rough around the edges, these guys, but I think I can work with them. Because there's some things you can't teach. There's some things that you gotta have the heart for it. Now, they might not have been educated men. They weren't Pharisees. They weren't raised up in the church. But Jesus saw that they had a heart for it. That's what he was looking for. He's always looking for your heart. Just because you don't have the education, I don't have a seminary degree, let me tell you something. But, you know, Michelangelo didn't need to go to art school. You know what I'm saying? Like, when you just got it in you, when it's something you're a part of, each and every one of you, you may have, just don't count yourself out. The Holy Spirit can use you. God has a plan for every one of us. If you knew my past and you knew where I came from, listen, I'm not going to tell you about that. I will tell you about Jody, though. No, I'm just kidding. He's not even here tonight to appreciate that, but I bet he's watching online. By the way, thank you guys for tuning in online. We just want to welcome you in. You're part of the family right here. Give him a hand, guys, our online team. So Jesus comes and picks his disciples, and he's now in, he's just overcome the enemy, and now he comes and he's like, man, I got to teach these guys some things. Because Jesus knows what's coming. And he knows that he's got to get them equipped. And he draws up to a mountainside. See, at this time, though, all the miracles have been going on. Man, Jesus was famous. Like, people were flocking in droves and multitudes. And everybody got to want a little piece of Jesus because he was healing people. Sometimes people will come after you for what you can give them. But it was the disciples that stuck with him through the thick and thin. These were the ones that he would see. What he did was he pulled aside, it says, and he starts to teach them. And the multitudes were gathered around listening. And we call this the Sermon on the Mount. It's the most famous sermon of all time that Jesus teaches. Everybody's heard of the Sermon on the Mount. Well, it, really what the Sermon on the Mount is, it's Jesus gathering his core team. And everybody gets to listen in, even you and I today. But what he was doing was he was teaching them things that were kingdom principles, stuff that had never been taught before. It was really radical of his day. He was telling them things like, you know, you may have heard you're not supposed to kill, but let me tell you, if you even hate somebody, you've already broken that commandment. He said, you might have heard that you're not supposed to lust after a woman or commit adultery with a woman. He said, but if you've even just so much as looked at a woman with lust, you've already done that. Jesus was revealing some things to him that had never been taught before, revealing some things to his disciples that had never been taught. And he gets to this part where he says, listen, he goes through the whole thing and he gets to this one part where he says, we got to talk about prayer. We got to talk about prayer. How do you pray? Matthew chapter 6, 7 through 10 is where I start tonight in my scripture. He says, and when you pray, he's talking to his disciples. He says, do not keep on babbling like the pagans, for they think they'll be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Aren't you glad that before you even ask, God already knows what you need? He says, this then is how you should pray. Everybody say how. See, we've thought for a long time now that Jesus said what. Have you ever heard a bunch of people getting around and just quoting the Lord's Prayer? Oh, listen, it's beautiful. I don't get me wrong. But that's not what he was saying. Jesus was giving them a model. And he says, this is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, holy is your name. This phrase just kicks me every time. He says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it's already done in heaven. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, God, help me to get this message out tonight. Lord, I believe beyond any shadow of a doubt, Father, that if I can get myself out of the way, Lord, that your anointing would be able to really rock some people's lives tonight. God, I believe that if we get the revelation of this, it will go to levels we never knew possible. Father, we are going to get breakthrough in our life if we can just take hold of this word. It's simple, but it's powerful. We thank you and we praise you, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Jesus said, this is how you should pray. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. What I want to talk to you about tonight is how God decided, this. What Jesus was saying here is so big, we missed it though, I think. I was laying in an ocean on a vacation, salt water, breeze, smelling that sun and air and just rolling the way. You ever like to do that down in Destin or somewhere? You know, I was just floating. And I'd pulled away from the busyness. This was years ago. And I was in the middle of preparing for a sermon message I was going to teach on prayer. And I remember thinking, God, prayer is kind of boring. Now listen, y'all don't throw no rocks at me, okay? I didn't have this revelation yet. I was like, whenever I was a kid, my great-grandfather would drag me to the prayer meetings on Saturday morning with the men's prayer breakfast. And the only thing we all looked forward to was a donut and a biscuit. The prayer, we were just like, let's just get this over with, you know? There would be some guy that was 90-plus snoring in the back. And I didn't get real moved by any of those prayers. Typically, you know, we don't get moved if we don't have revelation. But in that beach, in that ocean, just laying there, all of a sudden God began to speak to me as I started remembering this scripture about how Jesus said, this is how you should pray. And I was like, Lord, I realize that that's not him telling us that we should quote this verse. We're supposed to pray. This is how we pray. And I was like, well, what was he saying then? And this part leapt off the page at me. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. See, God has picked you and I to cooperate with as a team. Our job is to get our faith wrapped around things and speak things that are not as though they were. Our job is, listen, it's so important that God's will cannot be done in the earth unless you and I follow Jesus here and learn. Do you realize that? It is up to you and I. Isaiah said, here am I, send me. You and I, we have to have a willing spirit. There has to be a vessel. The oil will run out if there's no more vessels. We are in a place, in a time where Jesus is saying, listen, he's telling us, we got to get our faith strong because we have to pray through till breakthrough. But how many of you know, if it's so heavy, if learning to pray, have you ever prayed for something and it just didn't seem to come together? Let's just have a show of hands. How many of you? Yeah, you willing to admit? All right, amen, me too. Man, those of you who don't, one more time, hands up. look at somebody without their hand up, you need to go to that person, like right after service. Pray that they will give me a check for $100,000. At some, no, I'm just kidding. Because I turn right around and get, we'll pay that building off. I don't want to sound, I'm just trying to sound spiritual. I wouldn't. I'd probably be, the reason that God didn't give me the check yet is because I probably would go get in trouble, you know, and be like, okay, Lord, I'm going to skip a few Sundays. We're going back to the beach so I can get another message. No. All right. So here we see that we have to speak things that are not as though they were. We have to loose things using our faith. We're supposed to pray. Because, see, God has already loosed things in heaven. How many of you know that when Jesus died, what did he say? What was the words, the final words he said? Do you know it? It is what? Man, what does that mean? It means that he's already released it. Everything you could ever need, everything we want, everything we desire. I'm not talking about just to get rich. I'm talking about the things that you need. See, some things you need in your life are greater than others. There's some breakthroughs that are going to need. Listen, you can be praying for a new house and a new car, and I'm going to tell you something, okay? You will get some of those things because these principles are universal. They work when you put faith in. But there's so much. But some of you, you're going to come to a place where it's not just more money you're looking for. You're going to get empty with that. There's going to come a time when you get to a place where you're like, man, this is a life or death situation, God. If you don't heal this disease, my spouse might die. If you don't heal this situation in my life, this sin or addiction, I might destroy my family, God. Some breakthroughs are much more important. And I promise you this, for every breakthrough needed, there's a demonic assignment. There's an enemy standing guard over that thing. And if you don't learn how to do what we're teaching tonight, how to let your faith grow, how to pray through to break through, then you will sit under the oppression of that slave-driving enemy the rest of your days. That's what's at stake tonight. You being held captive in a prison. You listen, you might be able to go to work every day, make your paycheck every day. You might not get sick. You might live fine, but see, Satan don't care about some of those things. What he doesn't want for you to do is ever get an idea or a revelation of your authority in Christ. If you ever get an idea who you are, if you ever realize, wait a minute, I'm done with this stuff. See, there's the old circus elephant. I'm sure you've heard this before. Almost every preacher's told this story. The circus elephant, when it was a baby, it was tied to a little peg and had a little rope to its leg, and it would tug and pull and pull, and it could never get loose. And that thing grew one day to be thousands of pounds. At that point, it could have easily just plucked that little stob right out of the ground. But there came a day that it just settled with the fact that it could never do it, and it never tried again. Don't be like that elephant. Don't be like the tiger that was caged, and they lift the cage and he continues to walk the same parameter for all that time. That's what Satan wants to do. He wants to condition you and I and get our mindset. That's why Joyce Myers wrote a best-selling book called The Battlefield of the Mind. Because, listen, we need to know that the enemy is always going to work in our mind. He wants to program you. He wants to make sure that you know that you can't do it. You can be somebody quoting all day long, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, and the devil don't care at all because somewhere inside of you, there's something going on in your mind that says, but I know I can't. We've got to learn to line our, if you get your faith lined up with what God's word says, you will do, listen, Jesus said it. He said, nothing shall be impossible to you. So there's a lot at stake tonight. Matthew chapter 17, 20. If you're turning there with me. See, Jesus, he was grooming these guys, man. He had to make sure they understood. He taught them on prayer. He taught them, he said, make sure that you don't babble on with just a bunch of words. He said, you got to get your heart in it. You got to make sure that you're calling things out of heaven that's already been done. But listen, the battle comes in the time. We don't like to wait. We're an impatient people. I bet you every one of you that raised your hand when I asked if you'd had a... How many of you decided there was a day that that prayer was no longer something you would return to? You just finally, how many of you conceded? You did it by a show of hands. You just decided that, you know what? That prayer is never going to be answered. And that's exactly what I'm talking about tonight. Jesus is teaching the disciples. Again, he says, because you have so little faith. See, they were trying to cast demons out of this boy and heal him. And it just wasn't working for them. Jesus pulls aside privately his little core group and he says, because you have so little faith, truly I tell you, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there and it will. And then he says, nothing will be impossible to you. I got me a little seed. Can everybody see this? This is my faith seed. Why did Jesus use faith? Why did he use a seed when he was illustrating faith? Because what he's trying to teach us, y'all probably can't see my little pot here. I got some potting soil here. I got me a garden shovel. What he was trying to say was that faith is like a seed because inside of the seed, there's a lot of potential. This little seed, if you look at it through the natural eye, if you look at it in the right here and the right now, it just doesn't look like much, does it? Everybody see that? Some of you probably can't. It's so small. God said in his word, despise not the day of small beginnings. He said there's a reason for that. Because everything you do in the kingdom of God, it starts out with as a seed. When we take, Jesus said, faith is like a seed. And he used a mustard seed, which anyone in that day would have known it was the smallest of all the seeds. I've got an Altoid seed right here. You probably didn't know that Altoids grow on trees. But I had to make sure you could see it. So thank you, Pastor Darrell, for my Altoid seed. This seed of faith, Jesus was trying to teach his disciples. See, when I drop that into the soil here and I plant it, what we do is we sit there, we pace back and forth. God! Why are you not answering me? I don't understand, Lord. I prayed. I did. I went to church. I even tithed. I gave $50 to that building program. God, you know I've done everything that I should do, all the things I checked off my list. Still, you're not answering me. God, it's been 3 hours since I planted the seed, and yet I don't even see a plant. We laugh, but the truth is that's exactly what we do. We sit there and we ask God. We plant our seed of faith in prayer. But we never feed it. My first point tonight is you've got to feed your seed. How do you feed your seed? At the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus had another little portion of the scripture where he talks about, and he says, you've got to ask and it shall be given. You've got to seek and you will find. You've got to knock and the door will be opened unto you. Now, that's how you feed your seed. Hold with me here. We plant the seed in our prayer. The Bible says that this is a seed of faith, right? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. We've got to speak to our faith. In order for my faith to grow, I've planted my seed, but I've got to speak to it. And I've got to use God's word. When he said ask, you cannot ask. Asking in the Bible is like this. Jesus says, ask and it shall be given. It's a declaration. You can't ask without using your mouth. Have you ever asked anything without words? You have to use words. We've got to learn to ask. Asking is the verbal declaration. I speak words to my seed. I begin to use words. I say, if God be for me, who can be against me? God, I know I don't see anything right now, but I will walk by faith and not by sight. I'm speaking to that seed in Jesus' name. I'm feeling defeated though, see? Because you know what? You've got an enemy. That enemy is always in your ear. He's hoping that you'll listen to him. He's right there going, now you got, listen, stop looking at the seed. Start looking at the storm. Those waves are rocking. You're over here trying to plant a little seed. How's that little thing going to, when's the last time, did God come through last time? Let me tell you, you got to shut those voices out. We got to get over here and say, I will trust in the Lord with all my heart. I'll lean not in my own understanding, but in all my ways I'll acknowledge you. You will direct my path. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Oh, Lord Jesus, no weapon formed against me shall succeed in Jesus' name. You start speaking word into your situation. You look at your seed of faith you've planted, and you begin to feed it. You've got to feed your seed with the word of God. The next thing Jesus says is asked, and he says, seek. See, seeking is a term where we actually get the word see. He told Joshua. He said, Joshua, right before they were going into Jericho, they're all surrounding the place and everything, and he says, Joshua, come here. He says, I want you to see that I've already given it to you. Look at that fortified city. See it. Well, had God given it to him yet? No. How could he see that? How could he see that? He had to see it in his mind. See, here's something. I need an Abraham. Can you be my Abraham? God takes Abraham. He takes Abraham. You are an Abraham. I'm serious. He takes Abraham by the hand. He says, Abraham, I want you to look. He says, you know the thing you've asked me for? Look at the stars in the sky. I want you to see, there's that word again, that the answer to your prayer that I've got, you prayed for a child, but I come exceeding abundantly more than you ever asked or imagined. I've got the host of stars in the sky. He said, Abraham, look, I want you to see the sand. You see how many grains of sand there are? The thing that you asked me for, thank you, Abraham, thank you. The thing that you asked me for, are y'all getting what I'm saying? The thing that you asked me for, I'm answering in great abundance, far beyond anything you could ever amass. That is how God does things. He says far more than we could ask or what? Even imagine or think. He wants you to see it in your mind. Isn't that where you think? Isn't that where you do imagining? You can't seek something without looking through the eyes of your mind. That feeds your faith. So think, let's go back here, man. I got this seed planted. I'm speaking my word to it. I declare in Jesus' name, you shall live and not die. You've given, by your stripes I was healed. That sickness and disease has to go. And these are, listen, I'm using prayers that I actually do pray. These are the things I use. And I get kind of crazy. Sometimes you'll see me, I've got a rock in my fake sling, and I'm throwing it at giants and crazy stuff. If you saw me, you'd think I was nuts. But I'm going to tell you right now, I've been through some things. I've been through some stuff. 4 years ago, I was a cashier at McDonald's living in my parents' basement with a family, not knowing where we were going to go or how we were going to go or what we were going to do. Now I'm the vice president of sales for a technology company, and we have a beautiful home that God miraculously gave us. And listen, that's just surface stuff, okay? But when you're in that basement looking at walls, the mentality that the enemy is on right there, he tries to tell you, you can't do this. He tries to get inside of your head and make you feel hopeless and defeated. But I've got news for you. I begin to speak to my giants. I spoke to my mountains. Your mountain has to respond to your voice. I got my seed of faith planted. It's small, God. It doesn't look like much. I just went and got a job in McDonald's because, yeah, I've got more skills than that. But, Lord, it's a little seed, and I think you can work with it. Little did I know that the manager of that McDonald's had been a children's pastor years before, living up in New York City, and his mom died of cancer, and he got mad and angry with God and bitter, and he ran like Jonah down to South Georgia, and he set up shop in a little place in Bethlehem, Georgia, and that's where he manages this little McDonald's. And here God sends me, and I didn't understand why, God, am I having to go put my hands to the plow at a McDonald's. But you know what? Nothing against McDonald's, y'all. If somebody in here works at McDonald's, more power to you, okay? My son, I got hooked him up with a job over there. What I'm trying to say is this. Sometimes the mess you find yourself in didn't have anything to do with you. I had to go plant my seed, and God will do something with nothing. He will take the little things. I was declaring and speaking, but I had to wait because God had a plan, and I had to make sure and hold on to it. And you know what some people do? My point number two, don't leave your seed. Some people walk away from the seed. They say, that's a bunch of mess. That's never going to grow. What was I thinking? Don't leave your seed. Because what happened to me might happen to you is I found myself feeling like, God, why am I in this place, in this season, in this time, this difficulty? But when I got in there and started talking to Jeremy, that was my McDonald's manager buddy, realized right away why I was there. That man calls me. This has been 4 years ago now. He calls me about once every week. Hey, buddy, just want you to know, man, Jesus is so awesome. Love you so much. Because his life has changed. One of the general managers there ended up attempting suicide. Didn't work, and he came straight to me. We sat back in his office, in my office, actually, at the church. I was pastor at the time. That man, let me tell you, I never knew why. God, why am I having to go this path? I feel like I planted such a little seed, and it just looks like it can't be nothing. But see, when you put your little seed of nothing into the hand of God, and you trust him anyway, anything's possible. That man right now, I talked to him last Wednesday was the last time I talked to him. He is actually going through Church of God ministry school right now. He's leading mission trips and places overseas that I'm not aware of. He's linked up with some guys. And he calls me once every few weeks and just tells me, Pastor, I just want you to know what happened, man. We had 15 saved on the mission field. And I'm watching because you know what? All because I had to go through some stuff. Then I'll be honest with you. I was a little bitter and mad at God for about 5 seconds. Because I'm no fool. Listen, the enemy will get the best of us. Whatever you're going through, you're going to feel some emotion. You wouldn't be human if you didn't. But in just a few minutes, I caught myself. And I remember what I'm teaching you right now. And that is that you got to ask, declare that word, seek. See it in your mind, I saw better. Knock. Knock is what? That's a physical action step. You can't take hold of what God's planted in your life until you, what does it say? Faith without works is what? Am I wrong about this? I've laid it out to you. Faith without works is dead. You're sitting back praying and wailing and crying, going, God, I'm waiting on you, Lord. I'm waiting on you, Lord. And he says, listen up. I'm waiting on you to go to McDonald's. I'm waiting on you because you know what? I could have sat around and said, this is just must not be working out. It must not be my season. I don't know what to do, Lord, because McDonald's is beneath me, you know, and I just don't know what to do. But instead what I did is I said, God, I'm going to take an action step of some kind. I took a step in the right direction. It's one of the most powerful testimonies I tell to this day. I mean, it is, isn't it? It's a powerful story. You know what? If you didn't know me, you might think I made that kind of stuff up because these testimonies are so powerful. Let me make sure I'm staying on track here. I'm way off notes right now, but I'm still getting all the points. Don't leave your seed. Are you getting anything out of this tonight? Oh, thank you. Whatever you do, don't leave your seed. And remember this. This is what the Bible teaches us in Mark 11:24. Again, these are Jesus' words. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you receive it, and it will be yours. Now, do you know what in the Greek, in the original Hebrew text, actually, whatsoever means? It means whatever. You knew I was going to do it, right? I mean, every preacher does that joke. Right? It means exactly what it says. What is it that you have been asking God for that you feel like he's never going to come through? And it just doesn't seem like it's going to happen. But all the while, he's working. Your seed is growing. You just can't see it. But it could be Chinese bamboo. Do you know what Chinese bamboo is? Chinese bamboo is the kind of thing that you plant it in the ground. And it doesn't do anything for like, I don't know, those of you, is it 90 years or something like that? Like, it does nothing for a long time. And then when it begins to grow, it hits the season where it grows like 90 feet in the course of a week or two. It's a crazy, look up, Google Chinese bamboo when you get a chance. Because you know what, that's a great illustration for me in my life that I think, God, just because it doesn't look like you're doing anything right now, I know that you're working all things together for my good. I know that just because I don't understand that you're working things out. But see, the things that I've gone through, they were tough. They were hard. In that time, I couldn't see what I can tell you now. I didn't see the end result. Just like all the heroes of faith in the Bible, every one of them, David, Daniel, you look at it. They didn't know when they were in that moment. David didn't know how that was going to come out. What he did was he spoke word to his seed of faith. He said, you come at me with a spear and a sword, but I'm coming to you in the name of the Lord this day. He declared it in faith. You shall fall. I will take your head off. Then he took an action step, didn't he? Man, he went running right at that giant. He declared it, and he saw it, imagined in his mind what he was going to do to that giant. And then he went taking off, running after him. See, Jesus was teaching this. This is what I'm teaching us tonight. I'm reminding myself, because listen, I'm going to tell you, I've got the privilege of winning some great battles with this very message I'm giving you. Because see, there wasn't too many years ago that a family came to our church. Craig and Tanya, precious, precious people. They had been looking for a church to go to. And Craig and Tanya had been out of church for, I don't know how many years, maybe 9, 10 years. Seems like it was a long time. 9 or 10 years, Craig? They came to the church, and Craig and Tanya, Tanya had a thyroid issue that she had to take this medication for, and for 17 years, they had tried to have a child. 17 years. And every time they would get to the first trimester, right about there, her thyroid, she had to go off the medication because it would force the miscarriage. And so this happened time and time again. What would happen is that we're right up to that first trimester, and then her thyroid levels would start launching so high that the doctor would say, you've got to go back on this medication. And every time, six miscarriages. Do I have the number right? Six miscarriages. Imagine if after 17 years, you're praying, you're believing, you're trusting. Maybe you just get so mad at some point that you're like, God, I'm not even going to church anymore. I just don't feel like you even hear me. I planted my seed. We believed you the last 3, 4, 5 times even. And every time it's the same thing. Sixth time. They come to us and they say, listen, we started coming to the church and we pulled out. You haven't seen us probably for a couple months. And the reason for that is because we just had the sixth miscarriage. But we're excited to get plugged in now. They got plugged in. They were core team people. I mean, you couldn't ask for any better members than them. They were coming faithful. They finally come to us after several months. And they're like, we're so nervous. We're pregnant again. And they tell me this story. We've had six miscarriages trying for 17 years. And I was right in the middle of a series called See It and Say It, talking a lot about this same stuff right now, about how in order to accomplish God's will in your life, you got to be able to break through. You can't leave your seed. You got to speak to your seed and hold on until you pray through to break through. How many of you know when you're preaching a message as a pastor, you can get a lot of faith behind it for yourself? But when a family comes to you and says, for 17 years, we've had 6 miscarriages and not been able to have a child, and we're pregnant now, and we want you to pray with us about it. That's a lot of weight. It's a lot of weight, isn't it, Pastor? We go back and we pray over them. We bring the elders together. We anoint them with oil like the Bible teaches us to do. And here comes the day right up, next to that trimester, that breakthrough point, you know? She calls me up and she says, Pastor Jason, she says, my levels of my thyroid are elevated again. This is how it's happened every single time. And here we are, and we don't know what to do, but we need to pray. So they came to my office, and we met with them. And I remember I was just right in the middle of the series, so I had really had revelation. I was in the middle of a long-term fast as well, and my faith was high, thank God. Because let me tell you, it ain't me. It's not your pastors. You know, the Bible says that all we are is a vessel for God to work through. But let me tell you something. He works through you and me to accomplish His perfect will on the earth. We've got to be able to pull things out of the heavens and then manifest on the earth. Things that are much greater than you and I. So what we did is this, is exactly what I'm teaching you right now. We made a declaration. We prayed and we said, in Jesus' name, this child will live. And then we had to see it. I said, let's close our eyes right now. We're going to listen and hear the baby as he's born. I didn't say he. I said, we're going to hear this child as it's born. And I said, guys, I want you to smell the operating room. Feel the sound as they plop him on your chest. Hear the cry. I looked over and Tanya was just tears rolling. She said, I've never let myself see that. Craig right there with her. We prayed together, and I did my own envisioning. But I didn't tell them. I don't think I did. I may have told them, but I don't think I told them at that moment what I was seeing in my vision. Craig and Tanya, if y'all would, come up here. Bring little Raymond up here. This is a miracle child. Hey, buddy. Give me a five. He's so awesome. When he was a baby, I've got pictures of Craig. Craig ran sound for us. Holding him, and he was a little infant with a passy in his mouth and his hands straight up in the air when they were doing worship rehearsal practice. Am I right?
Definitely.
Yeah. So here's what happened. This is the end of the story. I'm about to close. Hold on with me one second. The day came for the baby dedication. And that was the moment that I told them. I said, listen, did I tell y'all before that? I don't think I did. I held that on. I held that little boy. And I said, when we were in the office that day, what you were picturing was the smell of the operating room and the sound of his cry. And I was picturing this moment right here. I pictured me holding that child, giving him to the Lord, doing the baby dedication, praying that prayer over his life. And we prayed over him. And let me tell you, he has got a special call on him, an anointing. Because, thank you, Jesus. You guys, every time, let me tell you, any of the seasons of my life that I get discouraged over anything, I can't look at that little boy's picture. How can you? And not go, what am I even worried about? Because you know what, guys? The last thing that builds your faith is not just God's word, but even as powerful, the Bible teaches us, as the blood of Jesus is the word of our testimony. It's the battles we fought and won. It's the things we've reached out into the heavens that had already been done, and we plucked them right out into the earth. And when they're living and breathing and right in front of us, man, the devil can't do anything about that. Thank you, guys. Give them a hand. Thank y'all so much. Thank you. We love y'all so much. Thank you so much. They came all the way an hour just so we could see this little guy right here. I love you, buddy. You wave at everybody? He's precious, isn't he? Man, I'm going to tell you, a living, breathing miracle. What if they'd have stopped, number six? What if they'd have stopped and never tried again? Some of you have just given up in your life on things. Could just be a different season now. We got to learn that the word of our testimony, that's the final step that will breathe life. And your seed begins to grow. And once it breaks through the soil one time, you hit another level. And the enemy can't do anything about that because you now have an experience that no one can take away from you. If you just keep running away from your seed and giving up every time, then the enemy can keep you in that loop, walking those 40 years over and over in the wilderness where nothing happens. But I'm here to declare to somebody tonight, the things that you've given up on, it is time for you to breathe that word over them. It's time for you to establish the testimony yourself. Because once you hit that level of faith, you are a danger to the enemy in the kingdom of hell. And God can use you, and you'll hit levels that, see, Jesus said, in my Father's house, there are many rooms. There's different levels, guys. What you've seen so far is nothing. He has so much more. And it all starts with us learning to feed our seed, not to leave our seed, and to pull things out of the heavens and let them manifest on the earth. Let our prayer tonight be, God, use me. With every head bowed and every eye closed in this place, what have you given up on? Maybe you were just trying to plant that seed in wintertime, and God said, if you just waited for your new season, spring is here. It's a time to plant. If that's you tonight, if you've given up on some things in your life, I just want you to hold up your hand. I'm going to pray with you tonight. I see those hands. Is there anyone else that would say, I want to pull things out of the spiritual realm and see them manifest on the earth? Raise your hand too. Hands going up everywhere. Father, in Jesus' mighty name, Lord, I declare right now, you said, be it unto us according to our faith. You said, whatsoever we ask, if we believe, it shall be ours. Lord, I declare right now, every hand raised in Jesus' name, God, that you move on your people, God. Lord, there's when a word like this is released, it's for a reason. Because your word never comes back empty, God. There's something you want to reveal and release in people's lives tonight. And it'll be something amazing and incredible. And they'll go to a level that they could never have gone to otherwise, God. I ask you, Father, to release it now in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Pastor Darrell.
Come on, y'all. Stand to your feet all over the house. Come on. What a good word. Great word. Come on. Give the Lord praise for that word tonight. Amen. Powerful, powerful concept. I'm going to tell you something. Once you learn this, it changes your life. It really does. I was sitting there thinking, man, I'm going to tell you something. It takes, for most people, it takes a long time to get there. But once you learn this concept, it can change your life. It can change the way you live. It can change the way you talk. It can change the way you act. Amen? Praise God. So thankful for it. And this couple that brought their child up, man, what a powerful testimony right there in that. Amen? God is good. Amen? So I don't know. I don't know who in here might be saying, you know what, just like Pastor Jason said, I don't know who's struggling with something in your life. But I'm going to tell you something. There's something powerful about standing in and believing God and speaking to the seed. Amen? Praise God. What a great word. What a great word. Listen, we're going to go home. Y'all ready to go home? Amen? Don't act like y'all. Well, you know. Amen? God is good. What a great looking crowd. Come on, let's give God praise for the crowd. Y'all looking like a Sunday morning in here on a Wednesday night. Hey, listen, I want to remind you of this one thing that you need to know before you walk out the door, all right? We are having one service. Everybody say one service. One service Sunday morning, and it is at 10:30. I need you to say 10:30, all right? So I know you got it. Amen. Hey, looking forward to that one service at 10:30 Sunday morning. It's going to be a great morning. Amen. And you come expecting. Can I get y'all to come expecting? Praise God. Come on now, come expecting, amen. Hey, y'all give it up again for Brother Mark Whitaker. He came and helped us out here these past two services. Come on, give it up for Andrea. Wasn't that a beautiful song that she done over there? Amen, amen. All right, all right. Slip your hands this way, everybody. Come on, slip your hands out. We're going to get super spiritual. Y'all ready? Y'all ready to receive something tonight? We've been talking about prayer. Amen. Y'all ready to receive that? Father, in the name that is above every name, the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the strong Son of God, we come before your presence tonight. Thank you tonight, God, that you have placed us in a place where we can hear a powerful word. Yes, Lord, let it sink deep in our hearts and become seeds in our heart, God, that wells up inside of our mouths, Lord. And Lord, we thank you and we praise you for the goodness of who you are. Now, Lord, I ask you to bless every single person. I ask you to bless them, bless their children, bless their families, Lord. I ask you, Lord, to open doors before them. I ask you, Lord, to go before them. I ask you to give them favor with every person that they stand before, every business deal, everything that comes up in their life. God, I ask you to give them wisdom and I ask you to give them knowledge. And Lord, thank you for allowing me to be a part of what you are doing and be connected to the household of faith. I give you praise for it. And now I declare I will leave this place and I will be full of the power of God. I will leave this place and I will go and be the witness that you have called me to be, in Jesus' name. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. We love you guys. We'll see you Sunday morning, 10:30. Amen.